Hello and welcome to the course on design patterns in C#. My name is Zoran Horvat. In this course I will show you a number of design patterns with their applications. But I will not just display the diagrams with an example or two. I don't see much value in that approach. I mean, that is not how real programming works. At your work you will start from the other end, from a requirement. And requirements don't name design patterns, you know. They are listing functionalities your customer wants to have. You will then experiment with a few ideas and eventually settle down with a piece of code. Then, where are the design patterns? Well, there will probably be none at this stage. Why? I won't tell you the answer right now. I want you to come to it on your own. Design patterns are defining protocols between objects. Take the abstract factory pattern as an example. It defines an interface consumed by the client object. At runtime, this interface will be represented by a concrete object. When the client calls into the abstract base, it will effectively execute a concrete method. But why would it do all this? Well, it calls the factory because it needs its product. The client knows precisely how to behave with that object, but it doesn't know how to construct it. That sounds ridiculous if you think about it. Why wouldn't it know how to construct an object? We will come to that in a minute and you will see that there are situations where this really happens. Alright, so we have an abstract factory, a concrete factory and a product. But the product is returned by the abstract factory and hence it should also be an abstract type. Abstract type shouldn't depend on concrete types. With the abstraction declared in one assembly and concrete implementation in another, making a back reference from abstract factory to concrete product wouldn't even build due to a circular dependency between assemblies. We break the circle by introducing an abstract product. And now we have a problem at the consuming end. Abstract product interface will probably be a stripped down variant of any concrete product or otherwise it would start leaking implementation. Increased abstractness of the product will make it harder for the client to use it for its own purposes. These are all general rules of object-oriented programming. I will not dive any deeper on them in this discussion. What I wanted to point out here is that now we have a completely insane piece of design. Why on earth would anyone write this? Someone would have to inject a concrete factory. The client would use it to get a product, which must be quite dull because it is abstract, to perform its duties. Let me give you an example and you will see the trouble right away. Books on design patterns often quote GUI libraries as an application of the abstract factory design pattern. Let's contemplate on this example for a moment. A method on the abstract factory creates a button. An abstract button, mind you. Now you wish to subscribe to events raised by the button. On MS Windows systems, buttons are just windows, each of them being associated with a unique handle. It is just an unsigned integer, nothing special. You would give Windows the handle and a pointer to a function to execute when an event is fired. Well, sorry. Handle is a concrete concept. You don't have it in an abstract button because it is supposed to suit iOS, Linux and whatnot in addition to Windows systems. Say goodbye to handles and start thinking of a universal abstraction identifying GUI elements. Another abstract type with another concrete implementation to wrap a native concept of a window handle. Seven types to handle a button. And we only needed two of them, the button and the handle. Now scale this to a 1,000 classes project and tell me straight. Would you like to have 3,000 types instead? Or 5,000 types? Back to the abstract factory with a single abstract product. Do you want to have 5 types in the project? Or just 2 of them, the client and the product? I'm pretty sure that you will pick the simple variant as your first choice. Programming is complex enough, you don't have to complicate it even more just for the sake of having a design pattern. A design pattern, like any other design element, must add something valuable to pay for its own complexity. and we haven't seen that something valuable so far. On the other hand, you may have noticed that this diagram here does not display the abstract factory pattern. It only displays a part of it. I was playing tricks with you, I admit, but I did it on purpose. True reason to introduce the abstract factory appears when there are two concrete products, not just one. With two products available, the client might have a hard time to choose which one to construct before using it. And that is precisely where abstract factory fits in. By choosing one concrete factory or the other, we are selecting the concrete product to hand over to the client. The client will eventually remain oblivious of the concrete type of the object it is using. All these types in the abstract factory pattern are just meant to make it possible to substitute one concrete product for the other. But now that it was said that way, the question comes. Why would we substitute products? Because they are working in different ways. Maybe it is an output device for a sound stream. One output is a file on disk, another is a network connection, yet another is the audio player. The client might generate some sound, and it would be our choice to save that to disk, send it to a remote service, or just play it on the speakers in real time. The choice is made by an outer orchestrator which is injecting concrete factory into the client. The client produces sound, and when it comes to passing it to the output, it uses the concrete factory to get hold of a concrete output device. The client could then, for example, clean up the work before completing. This is important because it emphasizes that this added, substitutable behavior is fitting in the middle of a larger behavior. The problem with that piece of behavior is that it needs to vary while the rest around stays fixed. That is where we normally use objects, because objects can be substituted. The fixed code makes a call into an injected object to run the varying part. Changing behavior boils down to choosing appropriate object to inject. And then comes the abstract factory applied to the sound processing component. Why abstract factory? For one thing, this component is only constructing one product. Why not applying the simple factory method pattern then? Or why factory at all? Why not a strategy? The whole object could be hidden behind a process called save. And when speaking of strategies, there is one special form of them in design patterns vocabulary, the template method. What if this component was abstract, with the save operation being the abstract method in it? Behavior would remain as before, but when the time comes to save the sound, it would simply invoke this yet-to-come save method. A concrete component would derive from this class and add a concrete save behavior before we can truly make any sounds. What I wanted to point out with this exercise is that even if you know precisely that there is a variation, and you know at least two concrete variants, and you know that design patterns support variation, you may still have a couple of them to choose from. If you started off implementing an abstract factory in this example, you may have already made a bad decision. It would cost you later, that is what I want you to see. There's no need to rush with design patterns. Just don't begin with them. Begin with real behavior. Listen to requirements. If you are practicing agile development, this part will come even easier to you. Read the user stories. As a composer, I want to be able to compose sound. As a composer, I want to save my sound to disk. I want to hear my sound. I want to send my sound to online library. The variation. There it comes. But it only comes after. Your initial design will let that composer produce sound. You might save it to disk for debugging purposes, maybe as an uncompressed byte stream. Not useful for real musicians, honestly. Then comes the second user story, saving sound to disk. Pull out the save method if you haven't already. Write a method to compress audio. Then save it to a file, with the file name becoming the varying parameter. Then comes the third user story, playing the sound. Audio devices normally work on non-compressed sound. Great, we have it. The play will send it to a playback device, though we will need the identity of the device. You see, different implementations have different parameters. And now, at last, we have two incompatible implementations. That gives us a reason to consider applying a design pattern. And then we think, which pattern? Is this a reusable concept? If yes, then give it a class of its own and produce it with a factory. Which factory? Is it an isolated concept? Then consider a factory method. Or is it one of the several related concepts? Then abstract factory is probably better. Otherwise, if this is a one-shot process, then we might consider strategies. Which strategies? Well, if this component is only doing this one thing, then maybe the template method is applicable. If it executes in different contexts, then we will be better off to separate from them with a proper strategy. What I'm trying to tell you is that choosing the right pattern is an organized effort, not just a whim or the question whether you like one pattern better than the other. The other side of the coin is when you can choose a pattern. You could not do that in the initial design because you didn't have enough information to decide. In this course, I will constantly push you to postpone design patterns. They come naturally and they come when needed. And when they do, they have an instant simplifying effect on the design. They don't just add new types, making the hard problem even harder. No, they normally remove loads of code and put it under the rug where you won't see it. And when that happens, you will know that you were right to add a pattern to your design. Conversely, when that doesn't happen, you will know that adding a pattern was not such a bright idea. By the way, what was that last user story? To send sound to the network service? Alright, now that we have decoupled the concepts, the remote service will only become one additional class in the design. If you were right in your selection, then the existing pattern will absorb the future request with no effort. Otherwise it might be a long weekend for you cleaning up the mess you made. Choose wisely. Choose late when you have enough information to decide right. After this long and detailed introduction, we are ready to start. In the rest of this module, I will tell you how the course is structured, where you can find the demo code and slides, and how to watch the course without losing track of what it is teaching. And, not least important, be informed that this course relates to other courses I have already prepared for you. Since design patterns help evolve the design, they are naturally bound to two programming concepts, refactoring and evolutionary design. You can learn more on these from my courses Refactoring to Design Patterns and Mastering Iterative Object-Oriented Design. These free courses are covering a large area of object-oriented design, which, in my opinion, every programmer should master.